So, the point behind it, or the rationale, is that World Rugby basically came out with the directive that we need to be better at protecting the players that play the game, specifically tied in with the blue card initiative. The contact to the head has been a major point and a major talking point, and we really need to address it. So basically, the idea of having these tougher sanctions is so that we eliminate, or at least try to mitigate, the impact of contact to the head in games. I'll just go through it and then we can talk about it. So basically, how we're going to start is it's a reckless tackle going down to an accidental tackle. Okay, so the first definition for a reckless tackle, basically, to summarise, is that the player should have or did know that they were going to make contact with another player's head or head neck region. Okay, and if we see a reckless tackle, the minimum sanction that we're going to give is a yellow card. Okay, if it's significant, we're going red card. But a reckless tackle is never going to be a penalty only anymore. Okay, the next one obviously is accidental, and basically that means is that there are mitigating circumstances around that tackle, i.e. a player falling over when the opposition player initially started his tackle low. Okay, so he never made, or never was at risk of hitting or making contact with another player's head or neck region, unless a specific event happened before that, so a slip or making contact lower and then sliding up. Okay, so we're happy with the definition between reckless and accidental? Perfect. So when we see contact to the head, we've got to think of three things. And these are the three things that I really want you to take out of it, because it can get quite complex. But the three things, we're going to look at the contact, so the location of the hit. So where was the contact first made? If it was below the shoulders, we're probably going to look at accidental because it slipped up. But if it's contact above the shoulders, then we're starting to look at reckless. Okay. The second thing will be the action. So obviously accidental, reckless, or deliberate. And the reason, if we're going deliberate, it's going to be a red card, because if somebody's deliberately made contact with somebody else's head, then we're going red card. Okay. That's why we're talking about the definition of accidental and reckless. The third thing, which is, I guess, the most complex thing, anyone can see the location and the action, but is the amount of force that was involved. And the amount of force is when we're going to decide between that yellow and red card. Okay? So the third thing that we're going to look at is force. All right, so that can happen in sequence. So we've seen the contact, it's high, the action was reckless, significant amount of force, those three things add up with looking at red card. See the contact, starts high, action was reckless, not that much force involved. Could have been an arm swung out as a player was getting beaten. We're looking at a yellow card. Okay? Does that make sense to everybody? Perfect. So the process that we will start with as referees is we ask ourselves the question, has foul play occurred? No, everyone's going to play on. I hope so. Alright? Has foul play occurred? Yes. We decide then on the action. So we've seen the contact. It was high, so foul play. We decide on the action. Was it reckless or accidental? Accidental, we're going penalty kick. Okay? Still foul play, so there must be a sanction. Penalty kick or advantage, but was it accidental or was it reckless or accidental? It was reckless. So immediately our sanction now becomes, our minimum one is yellow card. Okay? And then we look at the force to determine whether it was yellow card or red card. Okay? All make sense with that? Okay. So, as I said at the start, the new law is in place to enhance player safety. Okay, there's too many high shots going in. So World Rugby's put this initiative out, and now we need to embrace it and move forward. Okay, so you would have already heard with the blue card that the players and coaches and us as referees have equal responsibility in managing this. Okay, so coaches now, just a bit of personal experience, coaches now, we implemented this on the World Series, and coaches started to train their teams to tackle lower. Okay? First weekend, club rugby was the weekend, was Waka Nathan. Did you notice any drastic difference between coaches in the players' height, tackles?
No.
Seems like every count in my
head. Yeah. But, guys, I suggest that that's a perfect example. I suggest that the red card in that game has now made coaches aware that this actually is coming in. So I suggest that you will start to see coaches coach better and coach their players to tackle lower. Okay?
James, if I could just give an example. Yeah. The Blues pre-season, as a result of this interpretation or sanction coming in from World Rugby, actively practice their tackle technique to reduce the height of it. So that the hope is that the outcome of this will be obviously less contact with the head, but also certainly the height of the tackle being reduced.
So basically, we as referees, we need to be strong and follow these guidelines in order to get the change from coaches and players moving forward. Okay. The last thing that we need to be reminded about is that we are just getting the clear and obvious, okay? We're not going out looking for, and I guess this is where we got it wrong at national sevens. We're thinking any high contact, we're thinking yellow card. But it's just not the case. We can then decide whether it's reckless or accidental. So we're still getting the clear and obvious, okay? Guys, what I'd like to do now is just, if we could refocus in on the contact, so location of the first contact, the action, reckless or accidental, and then the amount of force involved to get where we need to be in a sanction. So I'd like to show some clips. There's 12 clips. And I'd like you to participate. So I don't want anyone just sitting down with no hand up. So I'll give you three options. There'll be a penalty kick, a yellow card, or a red card. All right, put your balls on the line, put your hand up. Okay? So we go through just the first clip, you'll get. No, it's not. Yeah, it's here.
Hey, he's stolen equipment.
Maybe a school teacher, eh? Okay, so there's 12 clips, guys. We'll go through one by one. I'll get you to put your hand up for one of those three options. Okay, you get two looks at it. I will stop it before the referee makes his decision. All right, first clip. Okay. So we'll go hands up if you think it's penalty only. Okay, yellow card. Okay, and red card. Okay. Can we go, what would you think it's a red card, if that's alright?
It's reckless and amount of force, quite a strong contact.
Okay. Okay. And yellow card, who put their hand up for a yellow card? Yep.
High, not a lot of force, so not a red, but pulled out.
Okay.
But I think it's still yellow.
Okay, cool. So we'll go back and look at it. Who said penalty? Yep, so.
Yeah, well, it was clearly high, but I didn't see any real intent, I didn't see any force, and the guy shoved him off as he went.
Yep, cool. Okay, so I'll take you through it. And so I've seen. So if I was refereeing, I'd go, okay, clearly there's contact being made to the head, the neck region. It wasn't so much reckless and so much deliberate. It's more of an accidental. He gets him around the chest region than shoulder, and then realizes that he's going high. So that force that's involved, or that action, is that he then realizes and sort of takes his arm away. So he doesn't follow through with the tackle. And then the force involved is minimal. So if I saw this, I'd be going penalty only. Okay, for the reasons that, yes, the first contact is with the head or shoulder or shoulders, and he realises, slips off, there's limited force involved, there's no follow through of the tackle. Yeah?
Can you go back to this, sorry, your presentation, Michael, you said that it was reckless that where the person should have known it could have hit the head, that was an automatic yellow.
Okay, yeah, so, I did, yeah, so if we go...
That looks pretty reckless.
Yeah. So I'd agree that you could probably have the reckless start to a tackle, alright? If he had followed through with that, so if he had recklessly put his hand in a position where he knew or should have known that he was going to make contact with the head, and then it grabbed him and followed through, I'd say yellow card. Because there's those three steps. Okay, so the action, or sorry, the location we've seen is high. And then the action, you can say reckless, but under that reckless accidental, I'd like to consider the follow through, okay? So if it's a soft contact, the opposition player is never really in that much danger there. Mm-hmm. In this particular, I'm not saying that he wouldn't be if there's a follow through, but the fact that he slips off, he's pulled out, that's where we go with the penalty only.
So then what you're saying is we need to look at almost the end result of the tackle rather than the not tackle the, itself, because it's still contradicting what your presentation, what you said before to this, okay. What you've said now. So you're saying now we need to look at sort of the end result. That's how you would have seen it, because
so I'd see,
the tension was there, but then went away by your previous presentation.
So then can we go back to that second step, that action step, okay? Reckless, deliberate, reckless or accidental, okay, if he had followed through with that, I'd classify that as reckless, okay? The fact that he's
reckless going directly for the head, and then after that, you can't mitigate stuff?
Yeah, so, I'm saying that if he's recklessly gone for that and followed through with it, then I'd classify that as reckless, but the fact that he hasn't followed through with it, so I'm watching the whole tackle, so not just the end result, but the start, contact is made first with the head. But remember that contact can be made first with the neck region, but then it can also then be accidental. And the reason that I would go not reckless in this case is that there was no follow through.
But isn't the point that he's tackling with bad technique by going up there?
100%, and that's why we need a penalty.
And therefore he should be, especially early on, we should be yellow carding that.
Well, I think the penalty itself is sufficient for that, okay? I understand what you're saying. And basically, guys, as referees, it comes back down to you have to decide what your reckless is. The point of tonight is to try and align us as best that we can to define and see pictures of what we classify as reckless and accidental.
So in that picture, see, penalty only, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, next video.
It's going to be a long night.
it is important to get that next one, so that hopefully we can go faster. But it is important. I don't want you just looking at the end result of a tackle. Look at the tackle as a whole, and then you can define based on whether he's followed through or not, whether you deem that as reckless the next time. Okay. Are we happy with that?
Yep.
All right. All right. My tackle two. Okay, penalty only. you taking it back down or what?
Just play on.
Yeah. So, yep, sweet. No one's got penalty only, so yellow card. Okay, cool. And red card. Okay, I'm actually happy with that. I'm actually happy with that. Basically, the split room comes down to the fact that you've identified that it does need a sanction, whether it be yellow or red. If that's your standard for red, that's fine, because you've gone through, you've classified it as reckless, you've classified that there's sufficient force involved. But I would say, with the red card, just watching the next or some of the other clips, and then maybe play this back in your mind and think how much force was involved. Okay? So when I said about the force, I'm talking about that guy that, you know, that gets beaten back on the inside, and a guy that's just hung his arm up, basically, because it's a rugby, you're desperate to tackle the person. It's a movement game and an intense game. The reaction of putting your arm out and catching somebody high obviously warrants a yellow card minimum, because it is reckless. Okay, no one's arguing that that's just accidental. That's reckless. He should have known that he shouldn't have done that. Okay. The amount of force, though, I want you to look critically at that. Okay?
I thought he slipped off the...
Yeah. So what I mean by that is that if he got beaten back on the inside and somebody's coming with a stiff arm swinging to his head, well, that's a significant amount of force. Him putting an arm out in a desperate hope to make the tackle, I'd say that would be, in comparison to what it could be, less force.
He came off his own feet, though.
Yeah.
So, James, are you saying force is more about the tackler, not how fast the tackle player runs him?
100%. It's about the tackler. Okay, how much force is the tackler going into that tackle or that contact situation? Okay? So, completely happy that there's yellow card, red card, okay? Because you've decided clearly that that's a red card threshold for you. Okay? Just when we do move forward, look critically at the amount of force involved. In this clip compared to another one, okay? Paul, do you have something to say, or you good? Yeah, cool. All right, high tackle 3.
Paul didn't see it, James.
Yeah, watching here. Penalty only, okay, and I know you're saying that the guy slipped a little bit, or lower tackle, lowered into it, okay, yellow card, okay, red card, okay, again fine, okay, because you've identified that the majority need a yellow card or red card. Who said red card? Can you talk me through your process?
Okay, so there's a significant amount of force as far as I was concerned.
Yep.
He was watching the player, it was deliberate,
yep.
And he slammed him.
Yep.
And so there was no attempt to minimise that or slow it down. Full force, knew what he was doing.
Yep. Okay, cool. So you followed the process. You've seen the context, the location's high. The action is he's followed through with reckless. And then there's a significant amount of force. Okay, so you've identified that it's high, the location, you've identified that it's reckless, and you've identified there's a significant amount of force. And again, happy that we are just trying to talk about what quantifies that significant amount of force for people. So, with that, I'd agree with you with that. And Pete?
So the fact that he slipped, that's why you took it from a red to a yellow. That's the only reason.
And that's fine, because that's your mitigating circumstance. Okay? So, cool. Yeah.
I was just going to say that the running position is
quite...
About
actually the next bit, yes, you're seeing now people effectively milking it, and I'm not saying the lower level stuff do it, but, you know, do you take into account anything after it, the way he lands or when he lands?
No, because I think you... So if somebody's rolling around on the floor or hurt, I mean... If anything, it just buys you a little bit of time to process what you've seen. I don't think we should ever start getting into the fact with this that a guy's lying on the floor waiting for you to make a decision. I just don't think that buys into it, because a guy could get clipped and be absolutely fine, but because it was high and because it looked worse, he might go down. So I think we need to look at it as the isolated incident of the contact rather than what the player then does afterwards.
I suppose, James, that the real benefit of those clear tests is you've got all of those things, everything happens to the player after the action.
Yeah.
So you can just do it on that basis. Step 1, 2, 3.
100%.
If the player runs up and gets off and comes back into the defensive line, Who's to say that player is any more in danger than the bloke who lies out for stone cold?
Well said, Dossie. So I think the fact that we're going at 1, 2, 3, the only time we ever look at the player who's been hit did he slip into it? Was there a mitigating circumstance? We don't then look at him afterwards after he's on the floor. Okay? You good? Or?
Yeah, this player was running at quite a low angle to start with anyway.
Yeah.
So what sort of emphasis would you put that on your decision making?
Well, it's up to you as a referee. If you decide that he's running at a low angle, his head's still there. Okay, so if he's running at that low angle at the same time and contact's made with the head, well, I'm not saying the head hasn't moved too much in that video. I know he's running low, but the guy who was making the tackle had a clear, you know, he knew that he was coming in at that angle. So he didn't make any effort to go lower.
Yeah,
he just stayed at that same height.
Mm.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So. Oh. Okay. Hands up, yellow card. Okay, and that's, again, fine, because, any red card? Good, thank you. So, who said yellow card? Do you want to talk us through?
The player, that was a little bit, but he was coming into it, the tackling player raised his arm deliberately on that level. And it seemed to me he clenched his fist as if he was waiting for the impact, so he knew where his arm was going.
Okay. Cool. Penalty only. Do you want to talk us through?
So when the contact happened, he didn't, as with the first one, the arm didn't go straight through, it sort of folded around, so that was sort of, it was high, and initial contact was high, it did, again, it wasn't reckless in that he kept going through, it was semi-accidental because he sort of lessened the impact.
Yep, so the second replay I think we agree looks worse than the first one because you've got a slow motion close up and if you really slowed that down, no one could really argue with you about a yellow card. But for what we're doing on a weekend, it almost looked like a bit of a bear hug to me. So the amount of force was minimal. So the player then didn't follow through, sort of let him go. Okay, so for me, that would be why it would be a penalty only. Okay. But second angle, if you saw the second angle, I can't argue with you about a yellow card. Okay. But on the weekend, if you see that, you're probably going to go penalty only because of the bear hug. Right? Minimal force involved. We go to a penalty only. Does that make sense? Card in this situation. I'll just explain my view on this because when I first saw it, I'm going, phew, red card. Okay? But what we're talking about with the mitigating circumstances that the player has stepped back on the inside, the player's then reactionarily put his hand out, didn't come through with a significant amount of force with his arm, sort of stuck a hand out in that hope to try and make the tackle. Okay? So, that's the mitigating circumstance that doesn't escalate it to a red. or brings him back down from the red for me. So that's a yellow card because the player's been beaten and it's just a reactionary hand flung rather than force coming through.
What's the difference between that and the example of Fekitoa and the Irish match last year?
So Fekitoa, brilliant. Fekitoa came through with a significant amount, a swinging arm right to the head. Okay? He wasn't beaten, it was a swinging arm. This one was beaten, it was just a hand chucked out. It looks bad. So I can, and I'll be honest, when I first saw this clip, I put down red card. And this is why we're doing this tonight, to try and align ourselves. So the reactionary hand flung out, not a swinging arm, very different, warrants the yellow card. Okay? Again, you as a referee, if you deem that to be a significant amount of force, well, you've still followed the process, okay? So you can still come out with a red card at the end of it. I'd say it'd be on the lower end of it, but I very orange, okay? Wish we did. Okay. Yeah. So I think, guys, the main concept that you should be picking up now is that it's the red cards are really going to stand out at you. They're really going to be, we can get along the same lines before I explain more, but so penalty kick and yellow card. Okay, red card. Good. At least, so the outcome of this in the game was yellow card penalty try, which then prompted a rethink, and the directive now is that it's a penalty. And if we watch it again, we'll just go through that process. Contact is high, player was, body light was low, so for me, probably more accidental than reckless, because another thing is if you watch the tackler's arm, he's sort of waiting for the player to come in rather than meeting the player. Okay? So that's where I would get reckless from. Accidental, not reckless. So if we watch it, not this angle, but the next angle, just watch the tackler and his actions and the amount of force that's really involved.
James, is the player on their feet that's receiving sanction or?
Yeah, it's, I mean, like, that's just a wee, like, tickle. it's the number 8.
I think the thing to remember with this example, it sort of highlights the reason for the law. The law has to be brought in for us to be sitting there worrying about guys diving the line to score a try, but it's to get rid of those really high dangerous tackles that we've seen in the previous clips.
Yeah. So that the guy's running, the ball carrier's run into his arm. It is high. Okay, so it was accidental, was contact high, so we are going penalty. Okay? But there's just not enough force and not enough of a reckless action by the tackler to warrant a yellow card.
What's the difference between that one and going back to that ruck one before you've got two crops, but that's just one of the smaller ones?
The ruck one, which?
Right back at the start.
Racing Metro one?
Yeah. So there was two crops, obviously, it's going to be
low. Yeah, so I think the big difference is that the ball carrier is going low because he's close to the line. Okay? The tackler is waiting for him to come. He's not gone with a stiff arm or a swinging arm to meet or to make contact with the head. Whereas the difference between the Racing Metro one was that the ball carrier was low, but he was low for an amount of time before the tackle with the contact area. And the Racing Metro guy came in always high, and he came in with force and met and made initiated the contact.
But if they're right on the try line, it'd be the same.
So you're saying that if that same thing happened on the try line,
there'd
still be a red card. So it's not because it's the try line. If that happened in midfield, that would still be a penalty only.
Yeah.
because of the not enough force and not enough of reckless action.
Okay.
Penalty only. Yellow card. Red card. Okay. Slowly getting more of a consistent lineup. So let's go through the process. Contact's high. Action. Who said penalty only? Yep. Accidental. But did he always mean to tackle him that high across the round the shoulders?
He just wants to stop him getting a bloody try. That's all he's after.
Yeah. So that's where I'm just trying to challenge some thinking around the accidental, because he's always gone high here. He's always coming around the shoulders. He's knowing he's going to make contact there, so it does become reckless when he makes contact with the head. Now, I'm not saying that every tackle over the shoulders has to be a yellow card, because I think if you grab somebody by the shoulders and just ride them down, then that becomes a penalty only. But the fact that he's gone, made contact over the shoulder, around the neck and head, what warrants the reckless. And then, especially the force in this one, while there's not a significant amount of force in the initial contact, it's what happens after that contact where he's actually followed through with the action, which is what I was getting at before, where there was no follow through in the first clip. There's definitely follow through here. Okay? So, contact high, in my opinion, reckless, because the player always meant to make contact there. He never tried to go around the waist, never tried to go around the boot, he's always gone high. We started out first clip, we had a third at each stage. Now we're really getting to just a couple of small outliers. Okay, so we are getting through the steps and are understanding what the level of sanctions are. So for this, Dossie,
yeah,
you said red card, mate.
The player, for me, notices, or at least senses danger, and seeks to do something about it, turns away from the tackle. That player has started high, has held it out at that height, and has made contact with the head, running good 5-6 metres into the tackle against a stationary player. I know I'm not supposed to look at what the ball carrier is doing, but I would have thought, again, that's in the orange for me, but given all of those facts in the background leading up to the contact, I'd expected that player to do a hell of a lot more in that situation. So that's why I'm quite happy to stop this game.
Okay. Yep. And the majority were yellow cards, so who wants to volunteer their process on that?
Force.
Yep. Force. Okay. So you've gone contacts high.
All those things you said, but just didn't have the force to wipe the red.
Perfect. Okay. So, I understand why you went there.
Yeah.
Again, and again, we're watching these in slow motion. I don't think anyone would red card that on the weekend. Okay, last clip. So the fact that he's gone over the shoulder, and I know the yellow card has come from the fact that his hand's sort of gone through or made contact with the head, but the force involved is so minimal that it's a brush on the way through, and he's gone around the shoulders, and he's actually just tackled him just high on the shoulders. There's not a significant amount of force involved. I understand there's follow through, but it's making the tackle around the shoulders, okay? So for me, the no force involved, the kind of just accidental nature of it, warrants the penalty only.
Okay.